Welcome. I'm David Eichholtz at David Richard Gallery, located here in New York City. And today I'm joined with Gabriel J. Shuldiner. And this is his work behind us. And so we're going to be discussing the work, which is a fairly comprehensive sort of survey of recent work. And we want to talk a number of things about his work. And it's for his new exhibition that is titled Translucent Saturation. And we've actually known Gabriel for quite a while. I think about 5 years ago.
5 years, exactly, yep.
And we had shows for him a number of years ago out west, when our gallery is located out west, but had sort of lost touch. And then he came into the gallery recently and to see another show that we had up of a friend of his, and we just sort of, you know, got reacquainted. And I went into a studio in Chelsea and took a look at the work. And I've always loved the work, and so I was real excited to see some of the things that have changed. Because when I first met you, a lot of your work was really with found materials. Mm-hmm. A lot of it, construction materials, mm-hmm. but you weren't too picky. I mean, you loved it when you saw a big piece of tarpaulin or rubber or you know, or roofing underlayment or shingles.
Certain materials just spoke to me, and I would pick them up.
Yeah, and so and what you did was your pieces came out of what that was, because you were limited with what the hall was for that day or defined at the moment.
Right. I was responding
and
then, to it.
Yeah, and you were responding to it. And so, and there was some editing and what have you, but the main thing about your work is it, and to this day, it, and from our conversations, still is very organically derived, mm-hmm. meaning to me that you respond to the materials, you respond to an impulse, and you don't sketch them out in advance, you know, but you do take notes and you go look back at your notes and think about things you want to do in the future. And so, but you do respond to the materials. But what I noticed in our discussion, and especially when I went to your studio, the big difference over the last 5 years of your work seems to be that many of the works are now initiated on a more traditional support.
Correct.
Canvas, paper, panel, and so, and some as a not necessarily as a result of that, but also more consciously, I think, look more painterly.
Yes.
And more like a traditional painting. Well, sort of, kind of. But, yes. But for you, it's sort of leaning that way.
Yeah.
But that's why we're starting on this wall. Because this wall has three works that kind of embrace what we want to start off in that initial introduction to show sort of this range. So what I would say is the one over here looks really sculptural and reminds me a lot of your initial work. Mm-hmm. And then this piece still is very sculptural, but you can see that it's contained, you know, in a frame that's all painted over, a la Howard Hodgkins.
Yep.
And then these two are very new. In fact, you just finished them this week.
Yep.
Because I told you I wanted to put them in the show. And so, and these definitely have a very gestural, painterly stroke about them. Yeah. But there's nothing conventional about the material, and we'll get to that. So that's where I'd like for you to sort of launch then. Sort of what led you then to decide to go to using a traditional support as sort of the foundation or you know, support for a lot of the work versus what you found?
Yeah, it seems like for me, it's like a natural development. So it's not like I had this like epiphany one day and said, I want to start using canvas again. It was really organic in terms of like I feel like I'm living within the history of painting and what a painting is and isn't. And for that reason, like I kind of just was, I've been drawn to the black square and the shape of rectangles, just so traditional, you know, for forever. When I go into a gallery, like even if I don't like the actual work that I'm looking at, I love the fact that it reads very traditionally. It's like just a personal preference of mine. Mm-hmm. So I kind of wanted to go back to that. Like when I started painting and I didn't really know what I was doing, like everything was on canvas and I would rip the canvas. And then I went through like different stages where you go off the canvas and take it off. And then you have like these found not found objects, but you have these like bizarre objects made out of just canvas. And then that, it's going back a while, ultimately led to the found objects and the recycling of materials. But I kind of wanted to get back to a connection directly to the history of painting. And it's one of the reasons why I went back. I was like, I'm not going to change how I work, but I want to change the support that I work on so that it reads more traditionally, you know, even though, like you said, not very traditionally. But that explains the move back to the square and the rectangle. It's kind of like, for me, it's like timeless, you know.
Right, and you use a brush, albeit very tiny.
I go through different phases as I make the work.
Right, but you're not limited to just the stroke you can make with a brush.
Correct.
I mean, you use, you know, obviously palette.
I make my own tools. I use palettes. Yeah. I use like pieces of rubber. Like I kind of, it's part of the excitement for me is to experiment with different ways to apply the paint, to apply the material. And if I'm using construction materials in the mix, like I obviously use more construction-based tools. Mm-hmm. And then I found like I found ways to like, you know, use a brush, but like edit it so that like the brush stroke is kind of like deliberately like screwed up because the brushes aren't full. Like it's one of my techniques. So I'll cut them and make them like, I'm used to like the striations that the brush and the paint stroke makes, just in terms of what I personally like with viewing other work. Like I'm just drawn to paint and like just the application and the different ways and how it's almost like within that confine of a painting, it's infinite how you can apply the paint. So that's a lot of the personal interests that drove me back to the traditional use of a rectangle and a square.
Right, and in a recent interview, and you and I have talked about this before too, so many people like you who that we represent and encounter are, you know, many different artists, this whole concept or period of where painting is dead, you know, but yet every time you turn around, it's like if you look at most graduates out of almost every MFA program, more than half of them are painters, you know, and want to do painting, or they start a painting, go to sculpture, come back to painting, or vice versa, or whatever.
Yeah.
But painting is still, you know, a method that is still, as you've pointed out, is still a method that people like expressing themselves, albeit a lot has changed over the last 40, 50 years, you know, with technological advancements, also with people now sort of breaking the boundaries of what's considered a material you could use for painting or for applying painting, just as you said.
Yep.
For example, you use concrete. And then these particular ones have concrete mixed in. And don't, trust me, people, they're not like a solid piece of concrete, it just, you know, but he does use all the different types like roofing alignment, shingles, you know, concrete, but you also do the same thing conversely with paint.
Correct.
So you use paint as glue, as medium, as a colorant.
I kind of feel like all my materials are democratic, you know, black is the one consistent. So I'll find myself, you know, literally painting with concrete one day and then painting with paint the next day. And
but you also said in that one interview that you're democratic in terms of the process because you spend as much time deconstructing or breaking things down, tearing
Everyone
them up, as you do rebuilding them or reconstructing them in a pictorial format.
Yeah. I view some of the, personally, I view my work as somewhat playful. I don't know if that comes across, but for me, there's an element of like, I mean, it's intentional. I know what I want to do, but in a lot of ways, it's fun, like playing with the different materials. It's like always a new discovery for me, how they work together, how they don't work together. It's like, that for me is part of the magic. So that's why I'm always kind of, you know, searching for different materials, and I have a whole list of new things that I'd like to work with. But ultimately, paint is involved.
Yeah, and it's interesting because you, these look very sculptural. When people look at them, that's their first impression. They go, I could even put that on a pedestal or whatever, which is usually how we all think of sculpture or something on the floor.
Yep.
But and you could if you want. You're not hell-bent on people hanging it on a wall. And in fact, your stuff is done in a way where it also sort of like, it could sit flat on a pedestal.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, or something.
Yep.
And so, but that wasn't my point. But your work does look very sculptural, but you say you're a painter. And so, what's interesting is you do like to use paint, but there's also, it's almost sort of like you hybridize also just, there's so much hybridity in everything you do.
Yes.
But between the painting and sculpting, And what I'm drawn to is like, there's almost like, you like the literalness of it. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, you have something and you don't want it to be illusory.
Right.
You make it literal. So yeah. There's like, you're borrowing from Jasper Johns. Yeah. I mean, like circle device and yeah. the spoon and things like that. It's right. like, don't give this illusion of it, yeah. you know, just do it, you
no,
know?
Like, what is it saying? It yeah. is what it is.
And
like,
so, know? And then that way your picture is not about a pictorial illusion. Mm-hmm. Your picture is, you know, it's the elements. Again, like borrowing from somebody,
like, yeah.
What did he say? Stella say, it is what it is?
Or, yeah, that was,
you know,
one, yeah.
Yeah, and you see what you get.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
So, you know, there's this literalness about
correct. Yeah.
The work.
And that's one thing that I'm definitely, like, I feel like from the tradition of painting, I've kind of, like, taken. Like, I do feel that there is, like I list my materials, and I use a lot of different materials in the work, but this piece is about the material. You know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
Like,
and also in this, and these are two different pieces,
yeah.
and we're going to get to this later, but you actually were looking at two different things here, playing with the surface sheen.
Exactly.
So matte and high
exactly.
gloss. So that's another element.
Yeah.
Of
I think
your
of them
work.
As like zeros and ones, and like the infinite, you know, way you can code computer programs. Like, so it's really like gloss is zero and like matte is one, and it's
yeah.
like an infinite. Play between
well,
those
it's
two.
Sort of like yeah. It's not digital is not the right word because there's nothing digital about your work. But yeah, it's that whole thing of it's a process and
right.
it's one or zero, one
yeah.
or zero. And so they also gets into about your work is you're really a process painter. So
yeah.
you, these two paintings are a good example. You
yeah.
don't necessarily work in series,
right.
but you do work. You have an idea. Or you start out organically and it generates an idea. Like you said, you make notes.
Yeah.
And so then you sometimes do another version
yeah.
that sort of starts out the same way,
right.
but deviates.
Right.
Or you consciously decide, like in this case, when I visited your studio, you said, you know, and this one was like totally matte, I think,
yep.
when I saw
yeah.
it. And you said, no, it's going to have some gloss
it's not done
in
yet.
It. You know, and but here, this one's more gloss,
yeah.
this one's more matte by and large,
yes.
but there is a mix in them. But I wouldn't say you work in series. But well, you tend to work around a cluster of things when you're trying to like experiment
yeah,
with something.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. What originally happened was because I was like anti-series, like each each object was like its own independent. You know.
Well, that's what I remember
right,
when
right.
I first met your
and
work.
Then
there
what
were
I started,
no two things alike.
Right. And then what I started doing, I added the saw, the electric saw, to like my oeuvre. So I started cutting the painting in half, literally, because like I would look at it and it was during the process and. I like how a lot of the work is like my scale so that I can manipulate the painting and turn it around and the back becomes the front, the front becomes back as part of the process. So at some point I'm looking at a piece and I'm thinking like, you know, it's not working, but then I see it cut in half. And so I went out and bought a chainsaw and I started doing that to my work. And then I said, it's a series, you know, two pieces. So that's kind of how it originally started. And then, you know, I kind of like my anti-series sentiment disappeared and I started thinking like in groups. And so it's like, I want to investigate something. I found that it was something that I could do in multiple ways. And again, that goes back to tradition. Like, you know, you have like, because I'm working on more of these, you have like seven rectangle paintings, all the same dimension. The only thing that changes is, you know, the manipulation of material. Again, that's very traditional, but that's something that I wanted to investigate and kind of led me back to doing more than just one piece.
Yeah, and that's, I think, a big difference, though, between, like, it's not like you have a long-term agenda or a problem you're trying to solve
right.
where you become, like, a systemic painter
right.
and you work only in series to resolve something, like a lot of color theorists
right.
and people tend to work that way because they're trying to resolve, you know, an issue around sort of in color interaction or
mm-hmm.
something. You have to, you know, it's very experimental
mm-hmm.
and you have to try different combinations.
Mm-hmm.
And in order to really kind of come to solve, you have a hypothesis and
yeah.
in order to solve it, you've got to do a lot of work.
Yeah.
Yours is more, you've got a hunch or something comes out of a painting and
yeah.
you decide you want to do, what if I did it that way or that
way? It's a feeling.
But it's
I mean,
like you still can't
yeah.
resist yourself
yeah.
from morphing it.
Right.
And so, because a lot of these, and that's one thing I was drawn to in your studio. I was sort of struck by, I saw something similar to that over there.
Right.
And indeed, you
right.
know, it was. And then you said, well, yeah, they were kind of, you know,
yeah.
just trying to do two different things.
Yeah.
So that is another aspect of this show that we are highlighting for you, is wherever things were sort of like, not everything's like, you know, matchy-matchy or to be like pairs, but there were some pairs where it was really interesting to see them because the dynamicness of the two together, you know, really was really very exciting, because while they each, you know, were interesting in and of themselves, together there was a different dialogue. There was almost like this internal discourse, not necessarily tension. While some of them, there isn't a tension between them. And so that's one of the things we're doing in this show, and we'll show the audience a couple of the other installation areas where some of that is sort of unraveled. But this was a good example to also then sort of highlight, not so much, I mean, not only just, you know, your sculpture painting, and in fact, the word you sort of coin for your work is brute minimalism.
Yeah.
Just as opposed to try and, because you don't fit into a...
I don't fit in anywhere.
And these paintings are not, or and these works are not a good example of sort of the minimalist reductive aspect. Many of your early ones were.
Yeah,
but they
I consider that reductive, but that's, it's you know, it's semantics. Like, you know, everyone views it differently. I think that, yeah, I don't know. Like, I guess it's different for everyone, but I would consider these two like super reductive in a weird kind of sculptural way, which is kind of like, doesn't make sense.
Well, yeah, I mean, there's minimalist in terms of palette as well. And you know, so black is the thing for you that sort of holds everything together. Yeah. Now, it's the other big difference between over the last 5 years, from when I first met you, everything was only black.
Yeah.
Now you're introducing a pop of color, or just an aspect of color, but it's not done to be decorative. It actually, what it's doing, I think, and maybe you, and you've never really said why, but what I think it does is it sort of accentuates or illuminates sort of the forms, some aspect about the forms, and or the interiors, because some of these are much, much deeper and more structured with sort of a portal or view inward. So it's almost like you're using that only to kind of direct the viewer as opposed to decorating.
Correct.
Is that a fair assessment?
That's totally fair. I mean, I like to reference like nature, because you know, this is where the color schemes that I use mostly seem to come from, just because I like the colors. But like, bumblebees and, you know, lightning bugs, like, you know, the beauty of the color that they use and the meaning of that color, and then how it's kind of been, you know, co-opted by humanity for construction sites, and like you have different, so I was drawn to those colors initially to do exactly what you said, to like, you know, I don't want people to just like dismiss, oh, they're black paintings, just dismissive. I wanted like a little bit of color just to kind of like hook the viewer in a weird way. And so initially I started using it almost as like making notes to myself. It's like there are different ways that I, different things that I definitely, like there's a lot of organic discovery while I'm making a piece that happens intuitively, but there's also a lot of like, you know, thought and specifics that I'm trying to get down. So what I find, I found myself doing is just make notes. I would take some spray paint and just like, you know, the yellow means to cut this part here, and then the fluorescent orange means flip that section over. So I would just like add it so that I remembered what to do later on. And then as the painting gets, you know, accumulated with like matter and finally resolves itself, the amount of color that's left over, which is unintentional from my notes, just happened. I just kind of left it. You know, I didn't go over it, I just left it alone, and then it started working as like this little...
Yeah, it's like a pedimenta.
Yeah,
it's like,
exactly.
It's the residue of the process,
exactly.
And you just, you don't try and erase it or get rid of it.
Originally, I did erase it. I was like, it's got to only be black. Yeah. But then I started leaving them in, and it was like, you know, it looked good, and it also did exactly what you suggested, you know, in terms of like, you know, sort of like hooking the viewer a little bit.
But you also had, maybe we'll wait till we get to the color for once, but so just back to black.
Mm-hmm.
Just sort of speak to your obsession with black, because it has been the focus of your work for a long, long time. And then I'll follow up with what I think the benefit of it is for you, for your process.
Cool.
But why
black?
Well,
I mean, I've always been drawn to black, and like I've tried to figure out why, and I don't know why. I've just always loved it. It's super powerful, and it's timeless. I love the fact that it's everywhere. You know, like I use carbon black pigment for like pretty much all my work. And carbon black, it's like, you know, it's everywhere. It's in printer ink. It's in, you know, tires. It's like, you know, it just forget how much carbon black pigment is created, but I looked it on Wikipedia once and it was just like an insane amount just for utilitarian usage. But why I'm drawn to it, to me, it's just like, it's like it's emotive, it's sexy, it's dangerous. It's like all the things that it makes me feel. I just didn't know you could paint in black when I started painting in black. And so, you know, I mean, I started self-taught before I went to art school. And like, you know, somewhere along the lines, I learned that you're never supposed to use black in painting and you're not supposed to use tape. I don't know where it came from, but I had these like rigid, weird rules in my head about like what you can or cannot do. And obviously I broke those rules, but I always felt it was kind of taboo. Then as I kept painting and I started researching the history of like, you know, carbon black, but also the history of painting and back from like the cave paintings that used black ash, like mm-hmm. I started realizing obviously, like, I'm not the only one to use this color. It's like got a whole history. And so I read up and absorbed that history. And then it became, I kind of felt like I'm part of it now and like respond to it and other work that's gone, you know, way before me that I'm always like, you know, like riffing on, like you could say like the black square and the history of the black square. And so like, that's my riff on that, you know, classic.
Yeah, we're definitely going to get painting into that series because that's a really interesting. But, and that is a series.
Yeah, but I don't think there is a color that is more magnificent, more powerful, and more emotive for me in the world. And so, ultimately, you know, the rigidity of the rules that I had in me instilled somewhere might have been grade school art class. I can't remember. But they were shattered, obviously. And then as I realized the whole history of black and painting, it just gave me more license to just say, you know, who cares about the
rules. But there is a benefit to having just the one color, even though we see you deploy it in a very diverse way, but you taking advantage of the sheen and what have you. But, you know, the surface, playing off this, leveraging the surface with a different sort of sheen or matte finish. But the thing is that what it allows you to do is focus on form.
Absolutely, yeah.
And it focus on gesture or shape. So it allows you to focus on the sort of things that a lot of times get lost when you're working only with color.
Yes, that is absolutely
true. And so I think what it ends up doing for you, though, and I think it's why when you also then add in your love, even though you still start with some sort of a structured traditional support, whether it's a panel or a canvas or paper, there's still this thing that you're drawn to found materials and to try this and residue.
Yep.
And so what it does is it allows you to still figure out a way to use those to communicate or to create a picture or a sensation. Because some of these are just like so luscious and juicy.
Yep.
And they're very sensual. Yeah. Some of them are very, you know, anthropomorphic or biological. There's something very corpuscular about them.
Yeah.
But then others are very sort of harsh, jagged, you know, and very, very geometric. Yeah. And so, you know, it's really interesting how you get this diversity, you know, with the...
Within the same color.
But just using the same color. Yeah. But what it does is it allows you to really expand your horizon of materials. Yeah. And using materials more and form more to express yourself versus palette.
Correct.
The color palette.
Yeah. That's a good read.
And so, you know, because you know, back when you think about, you know, color field painters, people use the square or the dots or, you know, grids or whatever. And many artists still do. And the grid is still one of the most, you know, forms that people still love to gravitate toward. Because what allowed them to do is just look at the interaction of the color, the relationships of color, without the composition affecting, you know, how you read the color. And also, it eliminates sort of that signifying effect when you have a form and a color together.
Yes.
Now you're just focused on the color when you're doing that way. Yeah. So in a way, this is sort of your version
of that.
That
is absolutely true.
It's just using black and now letting you explore materials or forms.
Yeah.
And the other was they were using the composition to eliminate that and only focus on color. Yeah. You're doing sort of
opposite.
The inverse of that.
Absolutely.
Is that a fair hypothesis?
That's
theory?
A very fair hypothesis. Yes.
Okay. So I think what we'll do is switch over to the wall where there's a number of them. that show what we were sort of talking about with the color. We'll talk a little bit more about color. And then I definitely want to go to the series where we, to talk about sort of painting.
Sure.
And really get more into painting. But when we get over there, all, in addition to color, I want you to talk more about some of your the people who really have influenced you, because clearly materiality is a big factor. And then I think there's a different group of artists, historical artists, that will have affected you in terms of, you know, painting per se.
Very cool.
So I think those are the, just to warm you up, those are the sort of
I'm
next
ready.
Topics.
Let's do it.
So we'll let the camera get switched around and we'll join you on the other side.